y'all can go ahead and have a seat. Like Panda said, my name is Austin.
What's up, Austin?
Hey, guys. And if you don't know me, I am a small group leader for the junior guys. Represent junior guys. That's right. Before I start, if you don't have a Bible, I would love for you to jump up and get one. There's some in the back. But as you do that, I have a question to ask you. Who is the most influential person in your life? Corey's holding up Bibles. She could be very influential right now to go get a Bible. Who is the most influential person in your life? When I kind of thought about that question a little bit, it reminded me of some people, and these people went through some great changes. Here are the people that came to mind. Number one, Darth Vader. Like, what happened to that guy for him to go from being a Sith Lord back to being a Jedi? Second person that came to mind, Fire Prince Zuko from Avatar The Last Airbender. Like, how did he go from wanting to hunt down and kill the Avatar to all of a sudden wanting to help the Avatar complete his mission? Like, what's going on there? Third person that came to mind was Steve from Stranger Things. End of season one, the final episode, how did he end up, like, going to ask for forgiveness from Nancy and then picking up the baseball bat to help kill the Demogorgon? Like, what's up with that? Another person that comes to mind, it's actually myself. I used to hate coffee. Now I can, chug it like it's water. Like, what happened to me? Final person that comes to mind is a friend who was raised in a non-Christian household. And partied all the way through high school, partied when he got to Texas A&M. But now he's a Jesus follower, and he feels called to ministry. What happened to that guy? What happens to people who go through great change? Have you ever stopped and considered that? What happens when a rebel turns into a hero? What happens when a foe turns into a friend? What happens when the bad guy turns into the good guy? And what about you? What has happened to you when you've gone through great change in your own life? Was it because a certain person influenced you, or was it because a circumstance and a setting surrounding you prompted you to change? Tonight, we are in our Empowered series in the book of Acts, and we are going to find ourselves in the midst of a redemption arc. We're about to see some great change happen in our scripture. And this is what you should grasp. If you remember one thing from tonight, this is what you should remember. Your life is redeemable in Jesus. Your life is redeemable in Jesus. So go ahead and open up your Bible with me to Acts chapter 9, verses 1 through 19. Acts chapter 9, verses 1 through 19. Now, as you turn there, I want to remind you and update you where we are at within the whole overarching narrative, the plot line of the book of Acts. If we were to kind of give a summarization of the structure of the book of Acts and try to use one Bible verse to do that, we would use Acts 1:8, which will be up on the screen. So don't feel like you have to turn there. This is what it says. But you, this is Jesus speaking, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the end of the earth. So what we see in Acts 1 through 7 is the disciples of Jesus ministering to people in Jerusalem, where all the Jews are. In Acts 7, a guy named Stephen is stoned because of his love for the Lord Jesus. And his death is what inspires people to bring the gospel message to Judea and Samaria. And eventually, by the end of the book of Acts, the gospel will be spread to what they would have thought would be the end of the world. So let's go ahead and jump into Acts chapter 9, and let's just focus on the first two verses. So verse 1, this is what it says. But Paul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues at Damascus, so that if he found any belonging to the way, men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. Verse 1 starts off with the word but, which means that there's a transition that is happening here in the scripture. The transition that's happening is what it's, we're transitioning from what we talked about last week in Acts chapter 7, the Ethiopian eunuch. Now, if something's kind of ringing in your ears, Ethiopian, Ethiopians were not Jews. So we can already see the gospel is spreading to people other than the Jews. It's going to Judea and Samaria. But Saul, still, that's the next few words that come up, still is kind of hinting at us, hey, Saul has come up before here in the book of Acts. And so we have to stop and think, what is this referencing back to? And the guy, Stephen, that I mentioned that was stoned to death, Saul, at the beginning of Acts chapter 8, approved of Stephen's execution. Paul was like fired up that Stephen got killed because he loved the Lord Jesus. In fact, Acts chapter 8, at the beginning, it says that Paul was ravaging the church and entering house after house, and he dragged off men and women and committed them to prison. And he's still doing that. He's breathing threats of murder to those disciples of the Lord Jesus who verse 2 calls or says that they belong to the way. That's just a phrase in the book of Acts to kind of refer to those who are Christians. And that's who Saul is trying to kill. And we have to pause and kind of step out of our 21st century mindset in order to realize the gravity of what's happening here with Saul, who's trying to kill Christians. For us to kind of get a better twist or understanding on this, Paul's basically like a terrorist. He is terrorizing people for their faith. And so we must continue on to see what happens as he's heading to Damascus. Verse 3, this is what it says. Now as he went on his way, he approached Damascus, and suddenly a light from heaven shone around him. Pause. Have y'all ever like taken a nap in the middle of the day and you have like fantastic curtains? Like I'm talking like the best curtains of all time. Like they let no sunlight in. So it's pitch dark in your room. And what do? Typically when you wake up from a nap, you pick up your phone. Now imagine your phone being fully bright. Like the brightness is all the way turned up. Your room's completely dark and you look at it and you're like, oh, I'm blinded. Imagine that, but like spotlight power. That's what's happening to Paul. So verse 4, in falling to the ground, he heard a voice saying to him, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? That word persecute, it means to harass someone for what they believe. Verse 5, and he, being Saul, said, who are you, Lord? And he said, I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. But rise and enter the city, and you will be told what you are to do. The men who are traveling with him stood speechless. Hearing the voice but seeing no one, Saul rose from the ground, and although his eyes were opened, he saw nothing. So they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus. And for 3 days he was without sight and neither ate nor drank. So what's happening? What just happened? Saul, the killer of Christians, just became a Christian. If we were to stop and think about who Saul is, if you guys have read the Bible before, have grown up in the church, you know that he also goes by Paul. But if we were to stop and consider Saul slash Paul and who he actually was, I think a good way to do that is to go to 1 Timothy 1:15. And it's actually a verse that Panda read in between our worship songs. And this is what 1 Timothy 1:15 says. Here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst. Emphasis on that end there. Of whom I am the worst. Hint, Paul was the worst of sinners, and we just see him experiencing this great change, this redemption, because he encountered Jesus, who has risen from the dead, ascended to heaven, and he encountered him on the road to Damascus. Saul is the worst of sinners. And so here's what I want us to grasp in this first part of our story. Jesus wants to redeem you even if you feel like the worst of sinners. Maybe if we were to have like a conversation over coffee or just out there during hangout time and we got a little bit deeper, you'd be like, yeah, Austin, Christianity sounds like a pretty cool thing, but if I'm honest, like, you don't really know me, and I've gone too far, I've run too far away, I've done too much icky, evil things to be a Christian. Or maybe you would kind of relate more so to where Paul has been. Now, he's the worst of sinners. He's killing Christians, throwing them in jail, persecuting them. But maybe the persecution that you have done of Christians you know isn't murdering them, isn't throwing them in jail. If so, please talk to Corey and Jeremy. I'm very concerned if that's the fact. But maybe it's more so just like, man, I scoff at Christians when I'm at school because they take their faith seriously, and I think the way they're living is kind of a joke, and I'd rather have fun. Or maybe you're kind of just here because your parents are making you come. You kind of question your parents for their faith in Christ, and you make little jokes towards them. That is what Paul saw was doing to Christians. And often, in our 21st century mindset, our Christian culture, Fort Worth Bible Belt, persecution often just looks like teasing and poking fun at people who are Christians. So Jesus wants to redeem you, even if you are the worst of sinners. No one is too far gone. Let's continue on and look at verse 10 in Acts chapter 9. Now there was a disciple at Damascus named Ananias. Pause in the middle of the verse. A few weeks ago, we looked at Acts chapter 9. There was also a guy named Ananias. That Ananias from Acts chapter 9 is dead. Like, he gone. Like, the Lord took care of him. There was sin in his heart. It was evil, and the Lord took care of him. So this is a new Ananias. Continuing on. The Lord said to him in a vision, Ananias. And he said, here I am, Lord. And the Lord said to him, rise and go to the street called Straight, and at the house of Judas, look for a man of Tarsus named Saul. For behold, he is praying. And he has seen in a vision a man named Ananias come in and lay his hands on him so that he might regain sight. Now, if I'm Ananias, I'm saying, Lord, no. Like, I love you, but no, that dude's going to kill me. Let's continue on and see Ananias' response. Verse 13, but Ananias answered, Lord, I have heard from many about this man, how much evil he has done to your saints in Jerusalem. And here he has the authority from the chief priests to bind all who call on your name. So Ananias has clearly heard of Saul and the evil that Saul has done. But the next verse gives insight to what Paul is waiting for in Damascus. And what Paul is waiting for is his instructions from the Lord about how he's supposed to live now that he has been redeemed. And this is what verse 15 says. But the Lord said to him, Ananias, go, for he, being Saul, is a chosen instrument of mine to carry my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. For I will show him how he must suffer for the sake of my name. In other words, Saul has been redeemed, but now he has responsibilities. If we were to think back to our Acts chapter 1, verse 8, and seeing how the gospel is spreading to the Jews in Acts 1 through 7, and then the Gentiles here where we're at in the book of Acts right now, we could almost say it like this. Paul was redeemed to reach Gentiles. And Gentiles were people who are not familiar with the Old Testament scriptures, who were not familiar with the concept of there being a Messiah or the Savior of the world. And Paul is the Lord's chosen instrument to bring the gospel to the Gentiles. So let's continue on and see how the story ends. Verse 17. So Ananias departed and entered the house. That's a bold man right there. And laying hands on him, he said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road by which you came, has sent me so that you may regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit." And immediately something like scales fell from his eyes, and he regained his sight. Then he rose and was baptized, and taking food, he was strengthened. So Ananias visits Saul, and how does he greet him? Even though he knows that Saul is a great killer of Christians, he greets him with, "Brother Saul." This is the way that Ananias would have greeted any other fellow Christian. He embraces him as he would identify with another Christian. And then Ananias ministers to Saul by helping him receive his sight back. Saul is filled with the Holy Spirit. And then Saul is baptized, which is just an outward expression of an inward transformation, which can only happen by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone. In other words, Saul was redeemed. So the bottom line is this: your life is redeemable in Jesus. Your life is redeemable in Jesus. So what does that mean for you? Well, if you're not a Christian and you want to become a Christian, if you sense any conviction of your sin right now, all you have to do is this. You just have to put your faith in Jesus, which means that he died on the cross, he rose from the dead, so that the gap, the strong divide between you and God, who's creator and sustainer of this world, is filled by Jesus. He pays your debt, and all you have to do is respond in faith and repent of your sins. And then you can be just like Saul, who experienced great redemption in this passage. You'd be baptized to tell the world that you have become a Christian. Now, if you proclaim to be a Christian, I'm curious. Is there people in your life that come to mind that you would say are too far off? Are they too far gone to become a Christian? If there are, and to be honest, there's some people really close to me in my own life who I think are too far gone to become a Christian. But we have to stop and consider, do you consider God powerful enough to make those people who seem too far gone like Saul become Christians? Or if you proclaim to be a Christian, are you willing to be used like Ananias, even if it means putting yourself at risk, encountering someone who might kind of tease or poke fun at you or make crude jokes about your faith, make you feel like you don't have any belonging in the world because they say that what you believe isn't true? Are you all willing to be used like Ananias was used to minister to Paul? I think of Romans 12:14, which talks about blessing those who persecute us. It's a great verse. You should go look it up. And finally, if you proclaim to be a Christian, are you willing to suffer for the sake of the gospel? If we were to skip to the end of Saul/Paul's life, he dies a death because of the gospel. Just like Stephen, who at the end of Acts chapter 7 died, while Saul is rooting and cheering on for Stephen to die, that's just like the death that Saul ends up experiencing experiencing at the end of his life. So are you willing to suffer for the sake of the gospel? Saul's conversion is a story of redemption. Just like Darth Vader's, just like Prince Zuko, just like Steve. I know, ladies, like, you love Steve, like, chill out, okay? Just like me, my relationship with coffee, and just like my friend who lived a lifestyle that was far away from the Lord, but then ended up becoming a Christian. So we have to, you know, think a little bit deeper. What happened to those people? Well, Darth Vader, he was influenced by his very own son, Luke Skywalker, who was used to bring him from the dark side back to the light side. Or Prince Zuko, the firebender, his uncle, General Iroh. Uncle Iroh, he loves tea, used to guide him in the direction of helping the Avatar instead of hurting the Avatar. Or Steve. Man, Nancy straight up broke that dude's heart. And it was that breakup that realized, that helped him realize, man, I'm a jerk and I need to go apologize to this girl. And in doing so, he also got a chance to try to save her from the Demogorgon with a baseball bat. For me, coffee, I used to hate it. There's this crazy woman who was actually my boss for a summer in Jamaica who legitimately forced me to drink black coffee. I'm not lying. It was terrible. My friend, who was not a Christian and lived a lifestyle that was not Christ-like at all, he had some friends in college who simply just brought him to a church one Sunday. His first Sunday at church, he heard the gospel preach. He repented of his sins and he put his faith in Christ. And as we are about to go into a time of worship, Saul was influenced by the Lord Jesus himself. Jesus came down, encountered Saul on the Damascus Road, and Saul became a Christian and was baptized. So I'm curious, what about you? Who's going to be the most influential person in your life? I say person because Jesus is a person. So remember this, your life is redeemable in Jesus. Let's pray. Father, thank you for sending your son here to this earth to die for us, to rise again after 3 days. And Lord, I thank you that you also sent Jesus to go encounter Saul on the Damascus Road so we can have so much of the New Testament. I pray that we see the great change that happened here in Scripture tonight. And Lord, we would consider what it would be like for us, maybe for the first time, to put our faith in Jesus, to also experience redemption. But Lord, I pray that if we are Christian, you would also encourage us to continuously, day by day, put our faith in you, repent of our sins, steward well the balancing of repentance and faith, and encourage us until either we are called home to be with you forever or until you come back. I pray these things in your name, Lord. Amen.